Thank you, everybody. This is the first time that I've ever been in an atheist space. I come from the small town of Gloucester, so almost. I do believe in full disclosure, if not for everyone else's comfort, but maybe for mine. Maybe I'm just talking myself through the nerves right now. I don't know. What I've prepared today is a conversation on a topic that I seldom, if ever, speak about, and certainly have never spoken about in public forum. Also, unfortunately, I didn't think ahead, and it's on my phone. So, at risk of looking too much like a teenager, that's what I'll be reading off of today. I'm not going to get too terribly far into the legal aspect of it. I'm going to focus today instead on talking about my experiences, not just as an atheist growing up, not just as an atheist transgender person, but also specifically as a transgender person. So, when my brother and I were born, we were twins. We were two bouncing baby boys. Him with a hole in his heart and a club foot, it's fine now, and me with an erroneous birth certificate, mistakenly designating me as a girl at birth. A designation that would hang insidiously over me for the foreseeable future, dictating what I could and could not do, and who I could and could not be. As I grew up in my Southern Baptist household with parents that held just about any prejudice you could consider, I realized quickly that there were several aspects of the life that I was born into that I did not actually subscribe to. For example, at the tender age of 8, when I could no longer walk about 400 feet to my friend's house because he was a boy, but my brother could. I was hurt because he was my friend, but I was also struck by the unfairness of it. Alongside that feeling, though, there was something else. Something I didn't know how to vocalize any other way than by saying, I'm just like him, I'm just like my twin brother. To me, that meant something far deeper than what my parents heard. The phrase was my liberation, if only I could translate it into a language that they would understand. But I couldn't. I could not. And this happened again when I wanted to play football. And this happened again when I did not want to play girls softball. And again when I had to wear a dress to my sister's wedding. And again when I held a girl's hand for the first time and I thought I was going to throw up because the butterflies were so strong and so wrong. I knew I was going to get emotional. I'm used to crying on stage. It don't even bother me anymore. It just costs me time at this point. I'll cry. I don't mind. Y'all don't care, I don't think. But these were things I couldn't or was not allowed to do, not because I was a girl, but because my parents did not know that I was a boy. And in a restrictive religious environment, it would be many long, traumatic years before I gained the language that would complete me. I remember so distinctly growing up in the church and asking questions that were not meant to be asked. I was left with angry Sunday school directors and an unsatisfied thirst for knowledge, and worse, a deep, pervasive terror in the Creator. My Sunday school teachers would tell me that my questioning was sinful. Could God see the doubt in my heart? Surely he could. Could he then also see how I played as a boy in my Pokemon games? Or how I played pretend in the woods, again as a boy? Could he also feel my fluttering heartbeat whenever I saw my female friend who I had a crush on? The latter few of these questions I dared not even fully form the thought of. The fear was there, but my mind was not my own. It was not safe from the prying eyes of an all-knowing and all-me-rejecting deity. Eventually, I stopped asking. Eventually, I stopped thinking. I accepted what my teachers and family and religious friends and inner circle were saying, and I looked no further. And not wanting to be further rejected, not wanting to be any more of an outsider than I already was, I jumped feet first into faith. Youth retreats, Christian concerts, they're bad. They are invariably bad. Picture a rock version of Jesus Loves Me. And, like, the most uncomfortably not funny comedian you have ever had the displeasure of coming into contact with. I became what I hated, someone who sang along to rock versions of Jesus Loves Me. But regardless of my commitment to the church, regardless of how many times I felt God in my heart, I still felt like an outsider. It was a club I could never quite get through the doors of. At the time, I thought my bouncer was Satan, and now I know it was my drive for knowledge. By this time, at this age, I would go right to the boys' section of the clothing store while insisting along the way that I was not gay. Of course, being understood to everybody else as a girl at the time. Then later, I would get on my computer and look through whatever LGBT media I could get my hands on until I had a shame-filled panic attack and deleted my browser history and ignored the computer for the next week. During that time, my pervasive fear of everlasting hell and a lack of privacy from my God had translated far more into real-world consequences. I was 10, 11, and desperate to die. Along with that, I thought that I'd come home from school to find police cars in my yard, waiting to cart me away for harmless, innocent little videos on YouTube or short stories on wherever. Not because any of this content was explicit, it never was, but because the content was LGBT. I was locked into a battle between wanting to stay at school, a place that caused me endless misery so that I didn't have to come home to police cars, and staying at home to avoid the torture of school and avoid the panic of searching for law enforcement vehicles on my way home. Around that time, I began looking more closely at the Bible. I would read and research it, looking for cherry-picked interpretations that would allow space for both my identity and my God. I realized, though, that that was not possible. If I was to believe the Bible, who said that who I thought I was at the time, a girl that liked girls, was wrong, if I was to believe the Bible, that was what the Bible was telling me, anyway. But why believe it when it also made countless contradictions and claims both improbable and impossible? The word atheist came to me then, which was so taboo that I hadn't even heard it spoken of growing up. It was the highest offense one could commit. As I began to consume atheist content, that God fear subsided some. It stuck with me for some time, even after I admitted to myself that God was not real, but not in the way it had been there before. I no longer felt compelled to throw up a prayer just in case. In fact, I still have the indoctrination of my upbringing hanging over me in some ways, but it was different, knowing that I wasn't the only one with these questions and these thoughts. It helped. Although in my small, conservative town, I didn't have anyone in my life to whom I could express these thoughts. Losing my religion opened up the door for me to think more critically about who I was. Words like lesbian and bisexual and even transgender became a part of my lexicon. Not just words I'd reject as quickly as I could out of mortal terror, I was able to play around with identity in a way that my puritanical religious inner circle did not allow for. And one day, it clicked. I was a boy. I was just like my brother, in the respect of us both being boys. Finally, my feeling had a name and a place. Finally, the little boy playing in the dirt and mud and going through the woods barefoot to find frogs and snakes and get yelled at by my mom for it. The little boy who played Pokemon under a table lamp because back then, Game Boys were not backlit. The little boy who hated pink and glitter with every angry bone in his body, despite not really knowing why, had been acknowledged and freed. I remember telling my mom I wasn't going to church anymore. By then, I had chopped all my hair off. I had hopped from church to church, exhausting our options, always complaining that I didn't like the service or I didn't fit in. I got in the car that night after youth group, and I told her that I wanted to stop going. "Well, that's the only place left," I remember her shouting at me, immediately angry, and I don't think she understood why. "You have to go somewhere. Church just isn't my thing," I remember saying. "It isn't your thing?" I just nodded, and I said, "It isn't my thing." And what occurred to my mother at that moment, I'm sure, scared her worse than anything she had ever encountered in her life before. And she said nothing else. And she didn't make me go to church. And I'm sure that that encounter had put her in mind of an earlier encounter in which I wasn't quite so successful at escaping church. I had told her that I wanted to attend the Gay Straight Alliance in my school, and she told me that I, first of all, should not be hanging out with those people, and second of all, could choose either between youth group and the GSA, which I was ecstatic to learn because that for me was two birds with one stone. So, it comes time for youth group, and you'll see me put the phone down as I'm telling stories about myself because I don't have to read about them. It came time for church, and my brother was getting ready, and I was not getting ready, and she came over and said, well, get ready for church. And I said I was given an ultimatum, and I've made my decision. And I felt very proud and grown up in that moment. But for her, it was more like a Hallmark moment where she could excuse her naughty son and still allow him to follow God. And so she said, well, that's all right, son. I'll let you go to both, but you better wear a hard hat inside. And what she meant by that is that our all-loving deity would bring the roof down on top of my head to crush me to death. That was a statement that she did not perceive as being traumatic or abusive because she had grown up in the same church that I had grown up in, and this was what she felt compelled to do to spread the love of her God. 2 years after I stopped my church going, I told my mom that I was a boy. By this time, she was healthier, more understanding. Our relationship was better. She would no longer say that neither gay men nor women belonged in the military, but would defend me and say that I could do whatever I wanted and love whoever I wanted, even against my father, who was still not used to the lesbian thing. So when I was 14, just before my first 14th birthday, or my 15th birthday rather, I came out to my mom. I told her what I had known for a very long time, even without having the words for much of that time. I told her that I was a boy, and she hugged me and told me that she loved me, and she told me that we would get through it. But she also told me that I could tell no one. Again, because my father was not used to the lesbian thing, but also because all of our extended friends and family, save for very, very few exceptions, were religious and conservative, perhaps even more so than even the environment I had grown up in. So, with my 15th birthday rapidly approaching, I became more and more upset, more and more depressed, catatonic. We had fights. I begged her to let me tell them who I was. I begged her to not make me be the birthday girl again because I knew it would kill me. And she didn't relent. And so the morning of my birthday party, the one I share with my twin brother, by the way, I get up and I walk downstairs and I look over at the sheet cake from Walmart, and it's got my brother's name on it and it's got my birth name on it. And I was devastated. So we had another fight. You couldn't have left it off the cake. You couldn't have done me that one kindness if you're going to make me go through the worst thing I'm ever going to have to go through in my life. You couldn't have done that for me. And so she was defensive, of course, because she didn't know what to do, and she was trying her hardest, and she knew she was hurting me. And so she lashed out and told me that she knew I was just determined to ruin this day for everybody. So I went up to my room and decided that it wasn't going to be my birthday. So some time later, my father comes into my room, and I don't know if this has been gathered so far, but me and my father don't talk about anything, but especially not about feelings. So he opens the door, and he's clearly out of his depth, and he knows it, and he sticks his head in, and he says, your mom tells me you're having some problems. And so my instinct, I'm an angry kid, and we don't have a relationship, and I want to be fighty, and I want to say, go away, I don't want to talk to you, Dad. But instead, I realized I could use this to my advantage. So I said, Mom said I can't tell you. So now it was mom's problem, not mine. So of course he goes downstairs, finds my mother who reports that she was crying in the flower bed, and asks what exactly it was that he could not tell, that I could not tell him. And that poor man got the brunt of all of my mother's angst from that moment to that moment, or from the moment I told her to that moment, which was very evident by his pale face when he walked back into my room. She told him then that I was a boy, that my name was Gavin, a name that she selected for me. She told him that it was not an option for him to respect me, and that she'd already printed out the divorce papers if he had a problem. And she meant it. So, while he went back up into my room to decide how to communicate what he'd just learned, mind you, again, still not used to the lesbian thing yet, and now he has this to grapple with, my mother calls all my family members and tells them much the same thing, except for the divorce. It's a bit easier to cut off sisters and uncles. She said, get rid of the pink cards. At this time, they're all mostly on their way on the road already. Throw them away. His name is Gavin. He's my son. He's a boy. And if you don't like it, don't show up. So my mother risked losing everything that mattered to her for the safety of her child. She could have, without question, potentially lost every member of her extended family, something that's very important for her. And in fact, a big section of our family did break off. And another big section of our family did break off. And it's not better yet. There's been some communication and some reconciliation, but things haven't been the same. And my mother took that risk, knowing that that was possible. So my dad sticks his head in my room, now white-faced. So your mom told me what's going on. I love you anyway. I don't get it, but I love you anyway. So my family members filter in, and it's very awkward. My mom had called me downstairs and was so excited, she had this grin on her face, and she told me what she did. And then she ushered me over to the cake, and she had scraped the wrong name off of it, and in expired green gel icing from the deepest, stickiest recesses of our cabinets, had pried up a tube of green gel icing and had written the name Gavin on my cake. So, thank you. So my family filters in, conservative and religious and awkward. Everyone is sounding a bit like my dad. No one's really making eye contact or even talking at all. And my brother comes down the stairs, and he does not read the atmosphere. So he's just happy as a clam, excited about the day, beep-bopping around. Hey, everybody, how are you doing? And then he gets to the cake. And he looks at the cake. And then he turns around, and he looks at my fear-stricken conservative family, and he says, why is the turtle's name on the cake? Because we had a turtle named Gavin, which my mom swears she was not aware of when naming me Gavin. But I'm named after a turtle. So everyone is realizing the same thing at the same time. He doesn't know. And none of my family members are willing or able to deal with that. So my mom nudges me and she goes, this one's yours. I got the rest. So I take my twin brother into the other room, who himself was not used to the lesbian thing yet. And I said, that's not the turtle's name. That's my name. I'm transgender. I'm a boy. And he said, no, you're not. And he ran out of the room. But didn't breathe another word about the turtle for the rest of the night. So that ultimately brings me to why I'm here today. Had I not come out to my mother, I don't know that I would have made it to 18. In fact, I know I would not have. But had I not come out to my mother, I also wouldn't have had to sue my school board, something that I do not regret for any moment. And I do want to touch briefly on the synopsis of that to help you understand what the timeline of the last 4 years of my life has been. When I entered sophomore year, I entered as Gavin. I was told I would be respected in the school, and I was allowed to use the boys' bathroom for 8 weeks. During that 8 weeks, nothing happened. Everything was fine. No one cared. And then parents decided to complain. And in a publicly facilitated conversation, an annual school board meeting, the school board spoke publicly about my genitals and bathroom usage in front of all the adults in my county, without telling myself or my family. We found out by chance because of a Facebook post that had gone viral in our local community urging people to speak up and get that girl out of the boys' room. So I went, and my mom went, and we both spoke, and the decision was postponed to the next meeting, which was so much more angry and so much more volatile and so much more scary. I was called a freak. I was likened to an animal. I was any female honorific you can think of. Even people would even restructure their sentences to get another one in there, an extra baby girl or little girl or young lady, anything. And I spoke again, and my parents spoke again, and they decided that I was not fit to be in the boys' room with the other boys. And either I could use the girls' room, or any one of the unisex bathrooms that they had constructed out of broom closets, an irony which I hope is not lost on this crowd, which I had not asked for, but which might as well have had a neon sign above them saying Gavin's bathroom. So, with the help of the American Civil Liberties Union, I sued the school. The case made it all the way up to the Supreme Court before going back down to a lower jurisdiction, where it may still reach the Supreme Court level again. There is just no predicting these sorts of things. And that is ongoing today. In fact, we could hear something back any day now. I wanted to tell these stories because the common theme here, be it in my court case, in my upbringing, or in the community response, any aspect of this has the common ground of religious abuse. Had religion not been such a pervasive entity in my household, I would not have grown up hating myself and not being myself and fearing for my life and eternal soul. That is something. No child should rest their head on their pillow at night and wonder if they will be boiled in fire for eternity. No child, no adult should have to reject or fear a part of themselves for fear of rejection for eternity again or from their community because of an uncertain eternity. This was religious abuse. I carry the scars today, and I think probably every one of us in here has that to some degree. Trans or not, these are abusive, manipulative tactics, and growing up under them is oppressive. This conversation has gone on for too long, the conversation of LGBTQ civil rights, without identifying the main factor that drives the conflict in the first place, which is religion. I am tired of pretending that religion is not playing the integral part of this argument and this confrontation. I am tired of pretending like just because there's some good Unitarian churches, for which I am very grateful, I'd rather you not hate me than be the Westboro Baptist Church. But because of the presence of entities like that, people pull back and say, well, not my church. You can't attack all religious people. And so that makes a barrier in the conversation where I can't talk about religion at all without people feeling attacked or offended. Because again, their church isn't like that. Their God isn't like that. I'm tired of that. By saying that their God and their church is not like that, what they're doing is removing themselves of the responsibility from that common book that hurts so many people. Religion does not have to take the form of a gun or a bomb in the hands of an extremist to be violent and to kill people. Just because one is harder to identify than the other, although certainly not from the sufferer, just because one is harder to identify than the other does not mean that we should be having a conversation about one and not about the other. Religion is pervasive. It is pervasive in our government. It is pervasive in our society. It is pervasive in the lives of every person, theist or non-theist, because it is an institution that is woven into the fabric of America, not because America is a religious country or not because it was based on religion or built on religion, but because the people in power are often so inclined. This creates a culture of silence and of pain and of abuse, which can often feel like there is no way to fight against. But with the help of communities like this, groups like this, conferences like this, bringing people together in a common space to share their pain openly and to talk about their experiences, that battleground is changing. There are more ways now than ever to fight against religious tyranny, and that is in part directly due to the efforts of groups like the American Atheist Association. So I want to, of course, thank them for having me here to share my story. Like I said at the beginning, I've never been able to share that part of my life with anybody. I've spoken about it to friends here and there, but this is not something that I've ever spoken openly about. I've never communicated the terror that my childhood hung under because explicitly, solely because of religion. So thank you all for being here for this talk. I'm going to, I think, open now for questions since we, I believe, have a bit of time left. I'm not sure how those questions are structured. I think I just call on people. Is that correct? Yeah. There's a mic? Okay. Okay, yeah, cool. Okay, so then with questions, I suppose you come up to the mic? Not you, of course. But just to, so I understand that that's how it's structured. Cool. Okay, so there's someone there.
Can I give you a hug?
Yes, ma'am. Of course.
You have a marvelous mother.
Thank you. Any hugs of those natures will be delivered directly to my mother. Yes. So I'm living in California now. I escaped Gloucester, Virginia. Berkeley City College is my greatest hope because I can walk there and into community college, so it's less expensive. So.
Thank you so much. Can you talk a little bit about, since you are very recently involved in church youth group, the impression and the response to LGBT issues from the church youth versus the church adults? Do you see a tide turning there from your own experience?
Right. So, you know, comparatively to the amount of time it's been since many of the people in the audience have been to new spaces for religious reasons, I'm only 6 years removed. But in that time, I've noticed peripherally through living in my community that still has a large number of youth involvement, that there has been an even greater shift from that time to even when I was in the church. When I went, I remember having conversations with the one very obviously gay kid and his friend about how the gay kid said, you know, well, I don't care if God hates me for this, I'm gonna have to be who I am. And then the friend said, well, but you'll go to hell for that. So do you really wanna be yourself? I mean, that was the conversation. So, unfortunately, I feel that the youth conversations are often just as toxic as the ones in adult communities because they're being fed the same information. But luckily, there is a massive trend in people my age, younger and a bit older as well, of societal change. And I think that that trickles down into church spaces as well. I think for sure, had I been in these church spaces 10 years ago, my experience would have probably been a lot worse than even how it was 6 years ago.
Oh, Gavin, what is the current relationship with your twin brother?
So my twin brother, I think I said when I spoke that I am the same as him, only in the respect of our genders, because my brother is unfortunately still a product of our small town. I've cracked away at him a little bit. I don't think he believes in God, but I think that scares him. Which is exciting. But he's very much a product of our small town. He's more conservative than I am and less willing to speak up and put himself in any kind of public eye. A big part of it is his fear of backlash from his religious, conservative, redneck inner circles who he gets a direct backlash because of me from. But he's a good person. I think he is a good person, and I think there's room for him to grow. If only he would get the hell out of Gloucester County, Virginia. I don't know that that will happen, but I hope so.
Hi. Thank you for. Oh, am I next?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Sorry, I just wanted to.
Oh no, you're fine. I just wanted to make sure. Thank you so much for your strength and your courage. You're very inspirational, and we all really appreciate that. And I love how proud and unapologetic you are. I think that is really important. I also wanted to say thank you for calling attention to public school districts and the oppression and discrimination and harm they cause to minority students, LGBT students specifically, every day. I think people really, really need to pay attention to their local school districts. I think this is a common problem that they're hurting their own kids, and sex education is a great example as well. I'm curious if you have thoughts about that and if you've done activism about sex ed. I know for LGBT kids it's extra harmful, but I'll let you answer that. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your question. So actually, that was, I dipped my toes into activism without really even knowing it in my freshman year of high school because of sex ed. I walk in and our instructor is sexist and religious, which is a common and wonderful combination. And he went through the line of, hey, kids, ball up a piece of paper, step on it, rip it, now smooth it back out. That's women when they have sex. They'll never be the same again. Mm-hmm. Other smash hits include, women, if you have a baby, the man can just leave. And now God's looking down on every one of you in the bedroom. The word condom never made an appearance. Only pictures of gonorrhea-stricken genitals. Because if you have sex, the girl will get pregnant and then you both die. So I got angry. I would spar with the teacher a bit, and ultimately I went to the administration in the school, not with the school board level, but in the school, and I said, what the hell? Do you hear? Are you understanding the kinds of messages we're getting as young people who, I promise, some of us are having sex, and that needs to be addressed? Well, if you say condom, you're condoning it. And that was the end of that conversation, unfortunately. Looking back, I should have done more, but, I mean, yeah, that played... It just was so disgusting and so uniquely religious in messaging. So, unfortunately, I did experience some of that.
My memory of your case, and please correct me if I'm wrong, is that it only addresses bathrooms and not locker rooms. So I'm wondering what decision was made about locker rooms that kept it from being an issue in the litigation. How did that happen, and how did you feel about that?
So the question of locker rooms was not relevant in my case because I had already completed physical education. In freshman year, after a couple of times, so just a quick little bit of trans 101 that I promise is relevant. Trans folks assigned female at birth that have had to go through female puberty or you know, female puberty often develop breasts, of course, and so one of the ways that transmasculine identified folks will combat that is by wearing a device called a binder, which is painful and awful and sweaty, and it presses your breasts down. This is not something that's easy to wear with gym outfits, and it's something I wore regularly even in freshman year, and so I think I went to like 2 gym classes and was like, this isn't gonna work. So then I skipped until they finally said, we won't make you go. So that's why locker rooms were not a problem for me at that point, because I kind of low-key opted out of gym the first year, and then that was it, I was done. But of course, I'm an advocate for any trans youth to be in spaces which align with their gender identity, bathrooms and locker rooms included.
What advice would you give to somebody whose family is struggling with LGBT identification?
It is very, very unfortunate that people can lose family for being themselves. And unfortunately, I have to say that they're not all going to come around. And you should try to take solace with and make peace with those that do support you. And those that do not, if they do truly care about you more than they care about whatever indoctrination that they went through growing up, they will find their way back to you and they will try to bridge that gap. But some people's hatred for things that are different or things that they don't understand are just too strong, and some people will lose family. I lost family. My viewpoint on that has been that the trash has taken itself out. I didn't want them in my life anyway. They were going to be toxic and hateful. So I would say, latch on to those that do support you if those people are in your life, and as far as those that don't, please try to make a degree of separation because their presence will be toxic and harmful to you.
Hey, Gavin, you indicated you were at a point of suicide at one point, and what could you tell the LGBT youth that are watching who can't tell their parents, are still being ostracized by their churches? What is that one it gets better message that you could pass on to them?
Well, that's the it gets better part is why I tell the story about my mother. She was one of the main aggressors, one of the main things pushing me to that point. And then she was the one who came in and righted her wrongs and saved my life. So I would say, you know, even she was so conservative and so, like, growing up, it was just appalling, disgusting. Totally different human being, but she made that change. And it's possible for others to do that as well. Absolutely. Although it comes with a but, there will still be people that won't. And so experiencing that in my younger childhood, I found spaces where I could still be myself. Either in role-playing games like Pokemon, where I would say that I was the boy because it looked cooler, or in, playing in real life, you know, playing pretend as a younger child, like any space that you can be yourself, take heart in, even if that space is virtual or online, because sometimes it has to be.
This is gonna be our last question.
Thank you. First off, thank you for speaking, because I mean, you brought tears to my eyes, especially when you're talking about your mom, because I think on some level we all have dealt with something in our own lives that our parents didn't necessarily agree with and didn't support us in, and the support that your mom gave you, man, it just really touches me. It does. It drives me to be a better parent. So with that in mind, what advice do you have parents, because I mean, in a group like this, in a growing culture like this, it's something that, you know, we're going to have to deal with. And obviously, I don't have a problem with my son being gay or bisexual or straight or trans. Whatever he is what he is, and I don't care. But I also understand, like you have mentioned, there's an entire other society that we have to deal with. It's not just confined to our house. It's not just how we treat our kids. It's how everybody else treats our kids. So how do we as parents go about giving that
continual support, and also with the understanding that sexuality changes over time. How you feel at 11 may not be how you feel at 12, 13, and it could definitely be way off than when you're 20, and really actually get to live and go off into society, into college, and realize who you are as a person. And I think you mentioned that as well, that we do suppress ourselves. Right. When we're in our parents' house, we suppress ourselves because we may not feel that we can talk about it. So how can we as parents be more open and open that dialogue for when it needs to be? And I'm going to take a seat over
here. Yeah. Well, so first of all, those, like, the language of different identities needs to be in the conversation from day one. Children need to grow up hearing the words bisexual, transgender, lesbian, and gay, and also knowing what those words mean, and knowing that they're not bad things and that they can be those things if they are those things. Your question also rings a bit to the concept of, well, if I let my kid transition, they'll be bullied at school. Your kid's gonna be bullied at school anyway. Unfortunately. Hopefully not, but unfortunately, in many cases, they are. And regardless, would you rather them have the torture of not being able to live authentically or to be their full selves and be therefore better equipped to deal with whatever bullies come their way? You're not doing your child any favors by protecting them, by not letting them be who they are, because you're afraid of public backlash. You're killing them. So that's something I would implore parents to keep in mind when because often it's a trap that we can fall into. We want the best for our kids. We love our kids. And so the best for my kid is to calm it down until we're in a better area or until they're older. That's not acceptable. And of course, with the concept of changing identities, have an open and honest dialogue to let them know that whoever they feel that they are at any given moment is okay, and they don't have to know right now. That's something I tell so many trans youth. You don't have to know right now. You can take your entire life to decide or figure out. You can be in your 90, you can be 99 and still not know, and that's okay, and that's a beautiful thing. So for sure, just listen to your kids, guys. Listen to their happiness. Understand what makes them happy, and do your best to support that and to facilitate that conversation.